Good morning and welcome to this, the seventh meeting of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. Can I ask if anyone's got a mobile device to have it switched on flight mode and on silent, please? We have apologies this morning from David Torrance, who's unwell and won't be joining us, and Alex will be joining us as soon as he can. So moving on to agenda item one is our inquiry this morning on the departure of the UK from the EU and the implications for equalities and human rights. And we have a panel with us this morning who are Lynn Welsh, who's the Head of Legal in Scotland, Equality and Human Rights Commission, and Judith Robison, who is the Chair of Scottish Human Rights Commission. Welcome and good morning, and thank you for coming along to the committee, and thank you so much for some of the written evidence that you've already provided and the support that you've given to some of the committee members in understanding the whole rights agenda. We appreciate all of your support, but we particularly appreciate you coming along to speak to us this morning on this very particular issue, which is about the implications of the human rights and rights-based policy should Scotland leave the UK leave the EU. I'm just going to go with a very broad opening question and ask you both if you could maybe give us some insight into the implications on the rights agenda and on the Human Rights Act and other international obligations should the UK leave the EU.
Right.
Judith, yeah.
Okay. So I think before turning to the implications of the legal protections of human rights, it's worth reflecting on some of the broader human rights concerns around Brexit. The first of these from our perspective being the impact on poverty and the inadequate standard of living that has happened and will happen in the short to medium term. So, for example, we can speculate Brexit is likely to have an almost immediate impact on people's rights to an adequate standard of living enshrined in the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights. The falling pound, at least in the short to medium term, will mean there are real rises in the cost of living, especially in relation to food and fuel. The UK relies heavily on food imports, 30% of its food, and the price of food will rise as sterling falls and remains low for a prolonged period. And food insecurity is already on the increase, you can see that through the increased reliance on food banks, and the proportion of people living in fuel poverty remains well above acceptable levels. And that's not likely to improve in the current post-Brexit economic climate. So I think it's worth making that point about this is not something for the longer term, this is something that's going to happen, it's happening now and will happen in the short term. In the longer term, we must be wary that the Brexit circumstances of economic uncertainty lead to a levelling down of workers' rights in the name of economic competitiveness. Unions have already expressed their concern about this. And on the flip side of that, a positive human rights record and progressive protection should be seen as a means of attracting inward investment and supporting people in supporting the economy, as opposed to a drive to the bottom, a race to the bottom in terms of workers' rights as a way of making our country more attractive, having removed ourselves from the EU. I mean, how long do you want me to go on for at this bit? Because I can give you quite a reasonable introduction and then
yeah,
then stop.
Fine.
Is that okay?
Yeah, no, carry on.
So if I cover the bases and then you can come back to me on some of the key points. So, in relation specifically to what the implications of Brexit in terms of legal protections, the Commission is concerned that human rights protecting fairness, justice, and dignity stand to be eroded as a result of the UK's changing relationship with Europe. The Charter of Fundamental Rights became legally binding on EU institutions and on national governments with the entry into force of the Treaty of Lisbon in 2009. It's directly applicable in domestic law of the UK by virtue of the European Communities Act and in Scotland by virtue of sections 29 and 57 of the Scotland Act. The Charter reaffirms the rights, freedoms and principles already recognised in EU law. It doesn't create any new rights and it's divided into a number of sections. But as the Charter of Fundamental Rights only applies where an EU member state acts within the EU law, within the scope of EU law, once the UK has formally left the EU, the Charter will cease to be binding on the UK and have effect in domestic law. So the current Charter, as it sits, provides a range of protections. It doesn't give us particularly new rights, but it provides those protections in relation to EU law, and when we leave, those protections will no longer be there. I can detail some of the protections if you like. The information is out there in the public domain. The Charter also contains rights and freedoms beyond those protected by the European Convention on Human Rights. Right to protection of personal data, that arts and scientific research shall be free of constraint, and that academic freedom shall be respected, the right to a fair trial, which is not restricted to civil rights and obligations and criminal charges. So there's a range of rights that go beyond the terms of the European Convention. So the loss, from our perspective, the potential loss is threefold. It would mean a reduction in human rights protections, basically the loss of charter protections within the scope of EU law, and where it goes beyond that into privacy, data protection, and a fair hearing. Furthermore, an EU exit may represent the loss of potential for the fuller protection of social rights or principles contained in the Charter. So this is what potentially could happen in the future. And if we're no longer in the EU, the progressive changes that would be made in the context of progress would no longer be something that the UK would be accessing. So that loss of potential progression would be gone. And finally, the Charter has been of value not only in its provision of substantive social rights, but in the contribution it makes to the interpretation of a range of rights. So, and its provision as what they call a consolidating instrument, something which brings together rights for and articulates and strengthens that's the scope of human rights. The other dynamic, which I think is important to outline, is the increased vulnerability of the European Convention on Human Rights. As you will know, the European Convention on Human Rights is not an instrument of the EU, it is an instrument of the Council of Europe, and therefore it is directly not under threat as a result of us leaving the EU. However, it's worth considering that the impact of the loss of the Charter and withdrawal from the EU is that the European Convention becomes increasingly vulnerable to UK withdrawal. As a deterrent to holding on to the Convention, EU membership is removed, and the mitigating protections provided by the Charter of Fundamental Rights are removed. So basically, the Charter itself exists. Apparently, there's some dispute as to whether or not membership of the EU technically requires states to be a signatory to the European Convention. At a level, it doesn't matter. The expectation is that the EU demands a high standard of human rights protections within its member states. Any attempt by the UK government to remove itself from the European Convention or to stand back from aspects of the European Convention would be, at the very least, distinctly frowned upon by the EU, and that would be something that they would be called to account for. When we leave the EU, that will no longer be the place. That will no longer be the case. So while there is no direct vulnerability to the European Convention of Human Rights as a result of leaving the EU, there is the kind of holding to account process that the EU provides on the UK in relation to its general expectations of the standards that countries are expected to meet will be withdrawn, which means that the ability of an administration in Westminster to stand back from some of the aspects of the European Convention is actually strengthened. And so that's of a significant concern, particularly given the context of the terms of the public debate around the European Convention and with standing back from aspects of it. So in summary, in terms of the actual implications on rights, and I'll stop there and allow you to ask questions on that or take that further. The principal risk is around the current impacts on the most vulnerable and marginalised today, economic uncertainty and the new trading environments leading to an erosion of rights, the loss of legal protections that the Charter itself provides, and then the risk to the European Convention on Human Rights and what the kind of backstop that Europe provides in that context. So that there would be our three kind of key points in relation to the potential risks.
Thanks very much, Judith. Lynn, do you want to?
Yeah, I'll maybe concentrate a wee bit more on the equality side, just to complement what Judith is saying about human rights. I mean, obviously, a lot of our equality rights in Britain came from the EU in the first place. A lot of them did, although they're now enshrined in the Equality Act 2010, most of them. And so when Brexit occurs, that act still remains in place. So there wouldn't be an immediate diminution necessarily of discrimination, excuse me, rights that are contained within the Equality Act. Although who knows going beyond that what might happen, because the underpinning EU requirements that mean that the Equality Act is as it is would be removed, and so it could be chipped away at as we go forward, which obviously as a Commission we wouldn't be wanting to see. But there are also, I suppose, rights that aren't put into the Equality Act that come directly from the EU, and those would drop away at an earlier stage, although the UK government have obviously said the Great Repeal Bill will hold those until they're given further consideration, which is certainly something that we would support. So they will hold the regulation that would disappear when the EU Act is removed in Britain, and allow all of that regulation to be considered properly and over a period of time, rather than it all just dropping off a cliff at the time that we Brexit. And we would want to see the UK government doing a full equality and human rights impact assessment of any suggestion that any of that law be removed as we go forward. So the Equality Act itself goes, in fact, beyond EU regulation in many areas, for example, goods and services protection and disability and sexual orientation, which isn't directly required by EU regs. And there is some concern that those areas, again, may be chipped away at more quickly, or that issues, for example, reducing the amount of money that you could get if you're successful in a discrimination claim, which isn't allowed under EU law, but when that goes, would be something that could be removed or reduced fairly quickly. And what we as a Commission hope to do, and perhaps I know others, academics and others, to start to try and map out ourselves where those areas are that might be under attack as we go forward, or indeed where there may be opportunities, if there are any, from coming away from EU regulation. There have been suggestions, for example, that we could extend stuff like positive action, which at the moment is stopped where it becomes positive discrimination under EU law. There might be more opportunity to extend that slightly further. Or the removal of procurement rules may allow an opportunity to look at building better equality and human rights considerations into procurement, to try and look at it in a positive aspect as well as the negative. But I suppose, like Judith, our concern is that we lose a Charter of Fundamental Rights, which is not only a human rights protection, but also an equality and anti-discrimination protection involved with it. It has the benefit, for example, that the non-discrimination part of the Charter doesn't need to attach to another right when you're making a claim in the way that the ECHR does. So you have to have a right to family life claim that you can then attach an anti-discrimination claim to, whereas if you use the Charter, you don't need to do that. You can just go out for non-discrimination, and we would lose that right as soon as we leave Brexit and the Charter falls. I suppose what we are also concerned about is the lack of continuing court decisions. A lot of the decisions that have been made in the European Court of Justice have been very influential in expanding and improving our equality legislation, looking at trans status, sexual orientation being a part of sex discrimination, looking at insurance payments and the difference in sex between the current insurance for men and women, various and many court decisions that have improved our legislation, and that no longer will be there. The rulings of the ECJ will not have the same kind of effect as they had previously. We have concerns that people may start to try to relitigate equality legislation if it's no longer being looked at through the lens of European regulation, which at the moment it needs to be, and the decisions of the ECJ. Will people start opening up stuff like equal pay again to sort of say, right, we don't need to consider it in light of what the EU think. In fact, we see our British legislation means this instead, would be a concern. And there are wider, I suppose, pieces of legislation from the EU that are in the pipeline that we may not see particularly as anti-discrimination legislation. There's a large European Accessibility Act, just as an example, that's in the pipeline from Europe, which opens up the requirement to have accessibility in relation to things like ticketing machines and ATMs, televisions, phones, an area that disabled people are constantly fighting to improve. And this Act would, once it gets through the EU, have brought in huge benefits for disabled people, but it's unlikely that's going to come through before we leave, and therefore we lose that ongoing influential legislation as well. So I suppose that covers our sort of general concerns, I think, around Brexit.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to, because of sort of a timing for this morning, I'm going to go to open questions to colleagues. Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much to Lynn and Judith for your presentations. I wonder if I've got a couple of questions, maybe to start with Judith, but Lynn, feel free to jump in if you want. I mean, I suppose the key one then is potential risk, because none of us actually know what's going to happen in the next 2 years, 3 years, and I suppose that's got to be the caveat. I suppose my first question is, if this Parliament or Westminster wants to re-legislate in regard to things that are at present within European law, there would be nothing to stop that happening. So the things that you've talked about, that might go, that might go, that might go, presumably over the next 2 to 3 years, if there is a will within this Parliament or Westminster, if that's appropriate, to legislate on that, that could happen. So why don't you think that will happen?
I think you're absolutely right, and we warmly welcome any statements, intents that would absolutely generate that. In fact, the bit I was going to go on to next is what can Scotland do in relation to that? What can the Parliament do? That not only is there nothing to stop the Parliament, but we would be recommending you proactively put steps in place to both ensure that in terms of take mitigating steps, so to really look at, within the competence of the Parliament, obviously, what areas you could build in protections that would have been lost, but maybe more progressively, actually put in place protections which currently do not exist. And so, and that would extend into aspects of law, like incorporation of economic, social, cultural rights, where the Parliament is extremely well placed to actually bring into Scottish law the ability for citizens to actually have recourse to redress in relation to those rights, and actually potentially take world-leading progress to do that. To be honest, you can do that now. You don't need to wait for Brexit in order to make that happen. That's something that you have within your gift. At Westminster, again, you're absolutely right. The Great Repeal Act, to some degree, depending what it looks like, no guarantees, but is intended to do just that. But the unfortunate circumstance is it doesn't provide. Once that's happened and we've left the EU, we can make progress, but there is distinct concern that for a whole range of reasons, and one key one for me is needing to have independent trade negotiations, providing a context in the UK where we see the need to undermine things like workers' rights, health and safety protections, a whole range of protections which don't come from the EU. We have them within domestic law, but in order to get for us to apparently create that competitiveness, that those things are removed or diminished or are gradually undermined. Now, clearly there's no guarantee and we could go further, but there are real risks.
I suppose just following the second question, following up, I think perhaps Lynn used the word chipped away a number of times in her presentation. And I suppose, kind of two questions about why do you think things might get chipped away? And ultimately, isn't it a positive thing that this Parliament, our courts, can ultimately make the decisions which reflect what the Scottish people, British people want? So again, I'm not quite sure why things necessarily need to be chipped away. That would have to be because there's a political will for that to happen. Are you sensing that coming? Or it just felt slightly negative, your presentation, if I'm honest. I think, and I just wonder if you maybe like to comment back on that.
Yeah, that probably is true. It was probably more negative than it perhaps should have been. I think when in our job as a regulator, we get concerned when there are changes as substantial as this. And as I say, we know that there will be likely a loss going forward if we don't remain within the EU regulatory framework. So even if we keep the legislation that we have now, it would take a great will of both parliaments, I guess, to try and progress changes that are made in Europe here also. It's quite possible to do that, you're right. And it's something that the Commission, I think, going forward, would very much want to look at and to keep people abreast of changes in Europe. But you're right, regulation and legislation could be made here. The couple of areas that I had maybe commented on, for example, the reduction in the amount of awards available in discrimination, we've looked at simply because the present government had previously considered and removing and or reducing that and then realised that they couldn't. So I suppose that was simply, we know they've looked at that already and had a view on it, and if that view continues, then that may be an issue once the EU regulation that stopped that falls. But yes, as I say, we hope that there are positive opportunities also that could come out of the EU, and we're trying to see what those might be, and like Judith, how much of that could be done here in Scotland. Obviously, equality of opportunity is generally, mostly, but not entirely reserved, and so it's perhaps more difficult in discrimination. But there are a number of areas. Public sector duty is an obvious example, but there are also areas around equality in housing, taxi regulation, education, where the Scottish Parliament has used its own rights not to create discrimination law, but equal opportunities legislation. And it would be good if the Parliament were able to consider further how those could be extended and how the new devolution of equal opportunities that came in Scotland Act this year could also be used to advance equal opportunities in Scotland.
Okay. Thank you.
One of the things, in order to realise some of those protections, and both your presentations, you're saying that there's work that could be done here. Have you done any work on the scale of that, and the implications for it? How long it would maybe take to, and what specific areas we should target in Scotland, but at a UK level as well, in order to ensure that some of those protections remained in place?
From my commission, the short answer is we're starting to. It's a huge piece of work.
It's huge.
I would think so, yes. Okay. If you want to think about it. It would be. We have already started and we're anyway looking at what the equal opportunities devolution may look like and what the Scottish Parliament could possibly do around that. It's not the clearest piece of legislation in the world. But now that we want to look much wider and consider what devolved rights, I suppose, come back from the EU, because not all of that will go to the Westminster government. Some of it will come here, and how much human rights and equality areas that could involve. it will take quite a bit of work to do, I think, but it is a piece of work that we will be doing across Britain and particularly in Scotland. And I suppose there are very early opportunities. Judith was talking about poverty. The socioeconomic duty, obviously, has now been devolved, or the right to trigger it in Scotland has now been devolved. And I think the present government have indicated that they would intend to do that relatively quickly. Now, that's not a panacea for the problems that may or may not arise from leaving Europe, but it would certainly be a good step forward that this Parliament and government could take.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you. I wonder if you would like to perhaps expand on the issue of employment law and workers' rights, because there's a huge amount of stuff has come out of Europe in relation to protection of workers. And I suppose there's two strands to the question. And one is the ongoing implications of the move towards leaving Europe, because in some areas there's a lot of resistance to the protections that have come out of Europe for workers. And I wonder if you have any concerns over almost a chipping away before we get to a point we'll leave Europe in some sectors of workers' protections. And obviously after we leave Europe, we are at risk of losing the protections and the employment legislation that comes from Europe. But is there a way post-Brexit that we could almost peg ourselves to what's happening in Europe so we match it?
Chipping away before we leave Brexit, I think the answer is no, shouldn't happen, because EU floor, if you like, will still be there, and so those can't be removed. And as the Great Repeal Bill, it would seem the UK government has committed itself to take all of stuff like the fixed time working and part time working, all of those regulations that might otherwise fall away, and keep them. And so we don't expect a diminution in those, hopefully ever, but certainly not for a period of time. I don't know if that...
I think it's worth adding as well that we will... Well, again, this is one of the big unknowns, what our actual trade relationship with Europe looks like. And the European Community's trade relationship demands some expectations around rights, aspects of human rights, aspects of workers' rights. It may be that in terms of a trade relationship with Europe, some of those, while it may not be something that we are actively, I'm not saying that we're going to wipe away our employment legislation, please don't misunderstand that, but while it may not be something that is protected by Europe, in terms of our relationship and our negotiated agreement with Europe, that may be aspects that we could both advocate for, look at and hold on to. So who we're having those relationships with will also have impact. How those trade negotiations are negotiated and what the substance of them are. And it's both to be welcomed and actively encouraged that we make rights, whether human rights, workers' rights, a key part of those negotiations, that they're not just either left off the ticket, but are actually part of the consideration. If they're not, then the risks increase over time. So I think that's an important aspect to be holding in our thoughts.
Yeah, but I suppose a concern of mine is if we wait to believe... I suppose a fear that it's too late, because we're already starting to slip. So part of those negotiations is there a job for Europe to do as well, so that when they are negotiating with us, it's up to them to say, if you want this, this is what we expect of you. So it's a kind of two sides to the coin.
That's exactly right, yes.
Yeah. I think they would, in all of their trade negotiations and setting up the economic area, for example, there is a requirement that you meet the employment rights generally if you want to trade. So it's very likely, I would guess, that those will be on the table from Europe anyway. Mm-hmm. And so again, it very much depends what kind of Brexit we have, the extent to which workers' rights would be affected at all.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Mary, thank you. Alex.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for your presentation. You rightly spoke about the fact that this Parliament is already empowered to go further in the human rights agenda, should it so wish, particularly with the incorporation of various international treaties into Scots law to give our citizenry access to justice. But yet that obviously is up to political will to do so. On political will, I wonder if the panel can give us their reflections on the fact that There is a certain element to which various administrations, both at Holyrood and Westminster, have hidden behind European rulings on unpalatable human rights decisions. So, for example, I'm thinking on things like prisoner voting. And I wonder now, with that sort of being withdrawn, and as we know, that kind of thing was used by the Leave campaign to further their cause, with that pressure or the reality of that being withdrawn from Europe, what do you think will happen, and is that now a subject of political will where we will have to take tough decisions and grown-up decisions, but we are empowered to do that, and do you see any barriers to us taking those decisions going forward?
So
quite a multifaceted question.
Yeah. I suppose, so fundamentally, there's a job to do to understand the human rights implications of any of this, but also to promote to the population that human rights are for everybody. So even prisoners have human rights. And so the characterization of unpalatable rights is something that the Parliament particularly could have play a particular role in making, as you say, mature and responsible. These are the fact that we would, as a civilized society, like to engage all of our citizens in the universal application of those rights, as is enshrined in the treaties that we are signed up to. So I think that's an important aspect of the whole terms of the debate. And in fact, the terms of the debate are something, again, which I think that the Parliament could play a significant role in improving, actually, and holding both themselves responsible for that process and others responsible for ensuring that the terms of the debate do not characterise decisions made around human rights, where they are genuinely holding our governments and our decisions to account for the rights of individuals in all sorts of settings, I think is really important. That's my kind of statement in relation to that fundamentally. Some of the specifics, yes, we have, there is real potential. And in fact, what's interesting about this, the whole terms of this whole debate, the public debate around Brexit, is the degree to which people's rights are being brought into sharp relief, are being brought into focus, partly because of the risks attached to it. And that does create an opportunity. It creates political space. It creates the space that the Parliament can move into to say, yeah, actually, we're going to take some progressive action here. We are going to act to ensure that the backstops, the protection that Europe provides, are going to not just be maintained, but be added to and developed and built on, and I think that message is potentially really positive. It's a positive one to our citizens, and a broader articulation of what the human rights agenda really means. That's something we all have. We all have in relation to almost all aspects of our life, and that the Parliament is going to be committed to ensuring that is a really important not just message but delivery.
Thank you. For the record, I don't find prisoner voting unpalatable at all, and I think it's absolutely something that we need to recognise as a fundamental human right. I think, reflecting on your answer, I welcome it, and I think that the challenge that before us now is to rise to that space, or grow into that space, that we have to take these adult decisions for ourselves. We can't rely on a European court handing down rulings that we have to follow and say that we don't like it or whatever when it's not palatable. But that is the challenge, and I think until this point, this Parliament has failed that challenge, particularly around incorporation of other rights treaties, where particularly in my own sphere of interest, and I declare an interest as a former convener of the Scottish Alliance for Children's Rights, that children don't have access to justice when their rights are impinged because we don't have incorporation of the UNCRC. So thank you for your response, and I think you articulate very well the challenge before this Parliament.
To add something else to that, because I think there's an important aspect that the Parliament can also take
take into consideration, as well as holding government to account for this. So it's not, I fully don't place all the responsibility on the Parliament, although as a big share of it. It is around that gap, that the potential opening of a gap between the rights that the EU goes on to provide to its members and the potential that if we don't monitor that, then our rights either go backwards or don't progress. And I think that for me is an important aspect of what the Parliament and the government, the Scottish Government, can do, is monitor that, make commitments to maintain the I think, Mary, you asked that made that specific point, maintain our the kind of rights and the that we have, and effectively either peg it to it, be explicit about that, or take that action as legislation goes forward within the EU. That is no small task. I mean, that's what Lynn said about the scale of that is huge, and so. An issue for me is the resources applied to that process and to maintaining that process within Scotland could be significant.
Can I just add quickly, of course, leaving Europe, the EU, does not mean that we leave the European Convention of Human Rights and the European Court of Human Rights. They're quite separate. And I don't think always the public perception sees a difference between the two. So the European Convention would still be there and be directly applicable. Yes, we as a commission also are very in favour of international treaties being incorporated properly into law, both here and down south, and especially where we may lose some rights through the leaving of Europe. Introducing those treaties may well fill some of that gap in discrimination law as well as in human rights law. And there is an opportunity, I guess, there's always an opportunity in Scotland. We can legislate in this way when we wish. We also, as a commission, are suggesting that if the Bill of Rights, the change to the Human Rights Act or a new Bill of Rights does come onto the table in the near future, that is, in fact, an opportunity to look at how you could take some of the Charter of Fundamental Rights, the EU Charter, and attach it to British law, British human rights law. So it's not always that we see the concerns around a Bill of Rights or a change to the Human Rights Act. There are opportunities there also to use that to expand and extend human rights in Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. I was going to come to that very point there. The UK government's made it pretty clear that it wants to abolish the Human Rights Act and replace it with this unknown Bill of Rights, whatever that may be. And I think and I hope that we guard against the notion that instead of this kind of sense of chipping away and we can replace things when we like at some future date, that I think at least some of us would think that's pretty naive to think that the UK is suddenly going to replace everything with something equally as good or better. And I think you've articulated some of the worries and fears that are justly being made. But in terms of Scotland's part in that process, our Parliament is required to act when it passes bills that they comply with these aspects and these obligations. How do you see that panning out if we lose the Human Rights Act and when Scotland's in a position where it wishes to retain it and is obliged to legislate and retain that in this Parliament?
That's a question. The Scotland Act presently requires the Scottish Parliament to legislate in line with human rights and in line with EU law. So both of those will have to be removed at some point, I guess, when we leave the EU and or if we do away with the Human Rights Act. And it would be for the Parliament here to take a view, I guess, on what happens in relation to that. Obviously, the Human Rights Act itself is a reserved enactment and therefore not one for the Scottish Parliament. But anything that follows that, since human rights is devolved, anything that follows that is absolutely in the hands of the Parliament. And so if you wouldn't want to see the human rights, the contents of the Human Rights Act go, or if you would want to go beyond that, that's perfectly open to this Parliament to do.
Yeah, at the moment, that is clearly a constitutional issue. We would still be bound by the terms of the European Convention. At the moment, there is no attempt or apparent threat, although it has been mentioned previously by Theresa May that that is something she thinks we should be potentially withdrawing from. That seems to have been put on hold. So we're still bound by the terms of the European Convention. The vagaries of the constitutional law as it would progress would be interesting. My expectation would be that any Bill of Rights that would be brought forward would be potentially the thing that might replace that within the Scotland Act. I know there are views within the Scottish Parliament and government as to the repeal of the Human Rights Act. Certainly from a Scottish Human Rights Commission perspective, we would oppose a repeal of the Human Rights Act. We think it provides strong and good protections in a whole range of areas, and there is no need to repeal it. Any further progressive we might want to make in relation of delivery of people's rights can be done through additional legislation, and I get the Parliament can do that, the government can do that, and that can happen at Westminster. So just to be clear, we are very clear that there is no need to repeal the Human Rights Act, and would oppose it, notwithstanding what the Scottish Parliament could do, the constitutional issues that raises. My understanding is that it's one of the constitutional issues are indeed one of the things, the big factors in preventing the repeal of the Human Rights Act, which clearly is, from my perspective, a positive thing.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Alec. Carry on, convener. Lynn, you talked about legislation that might be coming along from Europe that we would lose, therefore we would miss out on when the UK leaves the European Union, and you talked about some anti-discrimination measures and so on, and you mentioned things like ticketing machines and phones and TVs and stuff like that that would especially be of assistance to disabled people. I mean, for me, it's unthinkable that the UK would not want to comply with that, even from a trading perspective, if it wishes to remain and retain any kind of trading relationship with the European Union, as I'm sure it will try to negotiate. It would be utterly ridiculous for it to not observe, and in fact even be obliged to observe that kind of legislation when it comes through. I mean, Norway will be in a similar position if it wants to retain its trading association with the European Union. So the sense that the UK can walk away and take all these powers back and ignore everything that's happening in the European Union is really just a mirage, and it will have to comply, in my view. Do you have a view in that particular aspect of it, how the trading negotiation between the UK and European Union will pan out?
To be honest, it's so much of an it depends question at the moment that it's really quite difficult to answer that. When I give the example, I suppose I give it because if we had stayed in the EU, it would automatically become in its entirety part of, or would have to be transposed into UK law. Since that won't happen, how it comes in, if it comes in, the extent it comes in, will all entirely depend, you're right, on the relationship that we have with the EU going forward. It's likely, if there's a strong trade relationship, that yes, they would be required in some ways to comply, but it is just such a huge, it depends. Mm-hmm. I know that's unhelpful, but at the moment, that is the position.
I mean, the same would apply to the rights of, say, European Union citizens, should they remain in the UK, in terms of their rights and workers' rights and so on. And it would be hard for me, convener, to think that the European Union would be happy to enter into any kind of trade relationship with the UK were its own citizens to lose or their rights to be affected or diminished whilst remaining in the UK. Is that something that you think might be uppermost on the table for negotiation in the next few years?
Don't know is the short, truthful answer. I mean, we've certainly called on the UK government to clarify its take on how EU citizens presently in Britain should, what might happen to them. I know that the Scottish government, again, have been strong in welcoming and making its view clear of the additionality that our EU brethren bring to the country, but I honestly don't know what the UK government are likely to do in relation to their relationship with the EU as we go forward. It will again depend on what kind of Brexit relationship we end up with.
Judith?
I suppose, I mean, it's for me, this and many other issues are back to fundamental principles. And that's a situation that needs to be monitored and we need to be alert to. It's like, are people's rights being eroded? And if so, what are we going to do about that? So I suppose it's not so much for me the likelihood, it's what is the actual reality. So where is the terms of the debate? What is on the table? As we're not clearly a party to that. But also, if that comes out of it, then that is something that we have to be aware of and look for progress, not regression. That for me is back. That's the fundamental principle that we're looking for.
And I think we do have to ensure that we continue to condemn and stop the kind of hate crime issues that we're seeing, not so much in Scotland at all, but certainly in England and Wales, the sudden rush of abuse and hate crime that seemed to have bubbled up just after Brexit. So we all, again, must work hard to ensure that that doesn't take hold in any kind of way. And that people, while in Britain, are treated properly and respectfully.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Andy, did you want to...
See, during the sort of negotiations for Brexit, so Scotland are going to play a part with the UK government, is there an opportunity that the Scotland Bill can be changed so that more stuff is devolved to the Scottish Parliament through the negotiation process? So if they sort of, I can't meet and agree what both parliaments want, is there an opportunity that more can be devolved from the human rights to Scotland and actually change the Scotland Bill and add to it?
I mean, human rights are devolved.
Yeah, but I'm talking about when we're talking about the sort of the charter and things like that.
Yep.
So if we're saying that when we leave the EU, we sort of leave the charter, is that something that we could then say that we would take that on in Scotland?
The last Scotland Act round, there were calls by various organisations to devolve employment law and discrimination, equality law, as well. I think the SDUC had called for that, as had others. It wasn't something then that was on the table, I don't think, in the last Scotland Bill, but that is always open to negotiation, I guess, between the two parliaments.
I suppose if you're opening up the terms of the Scotland Act, because the relationship to the human rights legislation, to the Human Rights Act and the EU law has to be done. Mm-hmm. I suppose there is yes potential to look at other areas where you might want to further increase devolved powers. That's clearly entirely within the gift of political will. But yes, that potential's there.
Okay. Couple of other things I would want to ask you, but we've just some breaking news that the UK has lost its court fight on Article 50 and it would need to go to Parliament, apparently. So that's just breaking news. We don't know the details of that yet. So that puts a different complexion on the whole. This thing is a moving feast. It changes by the hour, obviously. But if we get back to the business of committee, because we're quickly running out of time for this session, we want to get on to the next session. There's one thing that really struck me recently is the number of projects and policy forums and actual practical help that's given to people to realise some of their rights, whether it's if you've got a disability and it's access to the job market, or support and advice for benefits, whether you're a young person and you've got some challenges in your life and the support that you get from that. A lot of that all comes from structural funds and EU structural funds in that sense. So in realising the rights of many people who would maybe be protected characteristic groups or marginalised groups, how do you see that moving forward? Because in a lot of cases, the law's great and we can all access the law should we want to, but for many people that's beyond their ability. And a lot of the organisations that certainly that I know and the groups that I know have worked directly in very practical ways to realise people's rights would maybe be under threat. And how would you see that undermine and maybe the progress that we have made?
That's an absolute, you're absolutely right to highlight that, and I think that's a really important aspect of the both the immediate implications and the kind of longer term implications of the way Europe has dispersed its funds and has attempted through that means to redistribute wealth. So that's effectively what it's doing. And so that aspect of that redistributive aspect will be to some degree lost. Now, from the perspective of the EU, we have clearly the capacity to mitigate that. We can put in place steps to say we will mitigate that. We will replace funding of the government. The UK government has said it, you know, it's going to do aspects of that, I think, till 2020. That's important. That's an important consideration beyond 2020. That's only 3.5 years away. The full realisation of people's rights in Scotland and in the rest of Britain, I think, is going to take longer than that. And so I think commitments from the Scottish Government, to mitigate the long-term impacts of that loss would be welcomed. I also think they need to be understood and mapped. And I don't think the full implications, the data around what the withdrawal of EU funding from communities around Scotland, the impact of that will be on people's rights, is understood. In fact, I was at a session a couple of weeks ago where Cambridge Academic was asking for an audit, a human rights audit on the impact of withdrawal, and I think that's a really interesting proposition, and important to actually understand. Okay, how is this impacting on people's rights? And really, that's an absolute aspect of it.
Yeah, it's a real worry. I think we've run out of time for your panel this morning, and we're really sorry that we're constrained by time, because I think we could talk in much greater detail about all of this, but I'm sure we'll be working together going forward. And can I thank you for your attendance at committee this morning and your support.
Thank you
very
much
to understand this. I'm going to briefly suspend in order to allow our witnesses to change over, so if you want a really quick cuppa, grab it now. stopped filling his face with patience. Good morning and welcome back to the Equalities and Human Rights Committee. We are moving on with our agenda item this morning about the implications on rights and human rights from a UK exit from the EU. And we are starting with our second panel of this morning. And with us this morning we have Dr. Tobias Locke, who's a senior lecturer in EU law and human rights, and Dr. Cormac McCauley, senior lecturer in law, both from the University of Edinburgh and both interested in human rights. With them this morning we have Professor Muriel Robinson, who is a lecturer in law of the University of Glasgow with a specific interest in equalities, and Professor Nicole Busby, professor of law at University of Strathclyde, again our equalities specialists this morning. Can I thank you all for coming along to committee this morning? I know that you managed to sit through the first session this morning, so you've got a fair idea where we're going to go with our questioning. And I'll open again with the same question I opened with earlier, was maybe if you could all give us, briefly, your thoughts on the implications of a UK exit from the EU on the rights-based agenda that we have here. And can I maybe start at this end, Tobias, and work over?
Okay, thank you. Well, just maybe to recap what we've got at the moment in UK and in Scottish law, we've got the Human Rights Act that incorporates the European Convention on Human Rights, and that, of course, has nothing to do with the EU, and therefore there will be no implications of Brexit, or no immediate implications of, that Brexit will have in that area. So the Human Rights Act will continue to be in place. Let's leave aside the British Bill of Rights discussion for a moment. But we've also got EU-based rights protections. On the one hand, we've got the Equality Act 2010 that is largely based on EU directives. The Equality Act is an act of Parliament, of the Westminster Parliament, and Brexit won't immediately affect it either, because unless it is, of course, expressly repealed or expressly amended by the Westminster Parliament, according to the procedures that they have to go through. The bit of EU law that is critical, I think, is the Charter of Fundamental Rights. The Charter of Fundamental Rights is part of the treaties of the EU. And of course, if the treaties cease to be binding on the UK with withdrawal from the EU, the Charter will cease to be binding on the UK. The only reason the Charter is applicable within the UK legal order is the European Communities Act 1972. If the European Communities Act 1972 is repealed, which is the whole point of the Brexit exercise, I would say, the Charter will lose its binding nature in UK law, unless, of course, the Great Repeal Bill or some other Act of Parliament keeps it alive for the time being. So that's the situation we have in a nutshell. Now, one thing that's important about the Charter is, of course, that it is not universally applicable. It only applies in Scotland and in the UK, where we are implementing EU law. And that happens in two broad scenarios. One is where a public authority is acting on the basis of EU law. Say a public authority requires somebody applying for planning permission to carry out an environmental impact assessment, something like that, something based on an EU directive. Or and the other situation is where a public authority derogates from EU free movement provisions. For instance, if we've got an EU citizen living here and they commit a crime and they're then asked to leave the country, they're being expelled. In that scenario, we not only have to take into account EU free movement law and the limitations on expulsion of EU citizens, but also the Charter and, you know, the right to family life as it's guaranteed by the Charter, and it can then be eventually decided by the Court of Justice of the EU. There's one other aspect maybe of the Charter that I should mention, is that the remedies we have in under the Charter are different to the remedies we have under the Human Rights Act. If you go to court and you say, well, my human right to, say, a fair trial has been infringed because an act of Parliament, of the Westminster Parliament, doesn't allow me to bring, to claim something, to make a claim in court, the best you can get out of the proceedings is a declaration of incompatibility. I mean, you still lose your case, okay, in the court, but the court can make a declaration of incompatibility, which can then lead to a quicker amendment of the Act in order to make it human rights compatible, but there is no guarantee that that will ever happen. And prisoner voting is a case in point. I mean, you know, there's been a declaration of incompatibility, a case in the European Court of Human Rights, the Act of Parliament is still there, it still doesn't allow prisoners the vote, and it's against the Human Rights Act, arguably. With the Charter, it would be different. If you're in the scope of the Charter, if you're acting within the scope of EU law as a public authority, you have the duty to ignore an Act of Parliament where it contravenes the Charter. And equally, if a court reviews the compatibility of an Act of Parliament with a Charter right, it has to set aside the Act of Parliament for those proceedings. That's what in EU law we call disapply. It's not invalidation. It doesn't lead to invalidation. It leads to disapplication of the Act of Parliament. And the claimant wins the case. So that's the key difference between the Charter. That's why the Charter has some practical value, even in light of the Human Rights Act. And that will be gone with Brexit, presumably.
OK. Dr. Cormack.
Thank you, Chairperson. Thanks for the invitation to be here. I should say, as a constitutional lawyer, I'm quite excited by this judgment, which we just heard of 10 minutes ago.
I can imagine.
just as a preliminary point, I think a good argument could be made that a legislative consent motion will be required from this Parliament in order for Westminster to be allowed to pass legislation to trigger Article 50. So it's something I think that will probably take up the business of this Parliament in the future. Moving on to the specific questions we were asked to address today, I just want to make two brief points. The first is, for me, the most significant impact of Brexit from a human rights point of view is the question of withdrawal from the European Convention of Human Rights. When this question was touted in the last 3-4 years, talking about a British Bill of Rights potential withdrawal, one of the major stumbling blocks that was put forward was, as EU member states, this will create problems for us as an EU member state because of the way the European Convention is kind of woven into EU law and the expectations of EU member states to respect human rights. With Brexit, I think that rather large obstacle to withdrawal from the ECHR itself has been removed. So I think that Brexit makes ECHR withdrawal easier. It facilitates ECHR withdrawal, and it will make it potentially more likely in the future, notwithstanding the fact that the current government has stated clearly that that is not its intention. The legal obstacles to ECHR withdrawal have been made easier after Brexit, and I think that's an important point that's worth emphasising. Secondly, with the implications specifically for Scotland, it's interesting when you look at the reserve provisions of the Scotland Act that some of the major areas that EU law has a strong fundamental rights protection are reserve matters. So if we look at things like data protection, which the EU law protects quite significantly, that is a reserve matter. Also consumer protection, equal opportunities, employment and industrial relations. This is very significant because obviously what happens at Westminster will have quite a profound impact on Scotland, and it's something that the Scottish Parliament itself couldn't legislate upon. So when we're looking at this question, I think we have to look at what is the likelihood that Westminster would implement parallel protections, because obviously it is within the competence of the Westminster Parliament post-Brexit to provide parallel cover, so to cover the gaps that EU law created by Brexit in terms of fundamental rights protection in certain areas. But we have to think about, in response to one of the questions earlier, what's the likelihood that that would happen? I think with this current government, I would say it's highly unlikely. The current Prime Minister, when she was Home Secretary, obviously had a lot of problems with the European Convention of Human Rights and the European Court of Human Rights. The previous government and the current government wants to repeal the Human Rights Act with the British Bill of Rights. And the Prime Minister herself, in her bid for, well, prior to becoming Prime Minister, did make an open speech that the UK should withdraw from the European Convention of Human Rights. So I think we have to look at this in terms of political likelihood, and certainly with the current government, I find that parallel protections would be extremely unlikely after Brexit. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Dr. Busby, Professor Busby, sorry.
Thank you, and thanks very much for the invitation to be here today. I agree with the points that have been made already, and also listening to Judith and Lynn's earlier comments. I'll just build on a couple of those. The protection of social standards, or the maintenance of protections around social standards, I think are particularly concerning. The loss of the non-regression principle, which is built into European law, which means that current standards or current protections, we can't go below those. We can only build on those or maintain them. The loss of that, I think, would have or potentially could have devastating effects for workers' rights. Law is not a static thing. It's not something that just stays still. It's constantly developing. And I think the worry about the levelling down of employment rights is a particular concern. If, in the case of a hard Brexit, those protections are withdrawn, and we see perhaps threats or vulnerabilities to human rights protections in the way that have been outlined coming into play. The need to compete globally without those protections, without the EU protections, without the non-regression principle, I think could be very concerning. Not just in terms of the sorts of equality rights that we see under the equality directives themselves, but also in other areas of workers' rights. The EU has been particularly active in protecting, for example, rights in transfer of undertakings through the Acquired Rights Directive. Working time legislation as well depends largely on European provisions, which are still being subject, as is the TUPE legislation, the transfer of undertakings, still subject to decisions by courts in the national context and the European Court of Justice itself. So you lose that potentially, and if we lose the developments that might happen through the case law, I think we stand to lose a lot. European case law, the case law of the Courts of Justice of the EU, has given us lots of progress in certain areas around equalities, around employment rights. Notable progress there relates to the rights of transsexual people, protection of employment rights for transsexuals, the development of associative discrimination. I think there are still things in the pipeline and potential that we don't yet know about, and that would worry me a lot. I think the interplay is very complex but very important, and it's where a lot of the progress actually happens around workers' rights and the protection and development, further development of workers' rights. So for me, that would be a major concern.
Thank you very much, Professor Robinson. Yes, so I agree that, as has been said, the vast majority of EU rights are implemented into British law through the Equality Act 2010, and that's obviously an Act of Parliament. And so, as Tobias has said, then Brexit won't have any immediate effect on that, especially when we've heard that the Great Repeal Bill will bring across all of the European laws, so that given that it's an Act of Parliament and not secondary legislation, it should be less vulnerable, certainly, to any immediate changes. But I think it has to be said that equality rights will be vulnerable when they're given, obviously, in Britain. We don't have a constitution. We don't have a constitutional guarantee to equality, and therefore it will depend on the political complexion of any government of the day as to what they subsequently do with the Equality Act rights. A lot of those, I think, are now entrenched, and there would be a very broad degree of political consensus regarding those rights. But I think for some, there's perhaps less political consensus about the appropriateness of legislating. Perhaps age discrimination is an example of that. But also, I think, where equality rights might be seen to impact on economic competitiveness, then these rights might be particularly vulnerable, depending on the complexion of the government who's making the decisions about equality rights going forward. And so I'm thinking they're particularly equal pay and possibly pregnancy, maternity rights and protections. Having said that, it occurs to me that might, to a certain extent, present some opportunities This Parliament has obviously been given slightly more powers in relation to equal opportunities, so some further powers devolved through the 2016 Scotland Act, which will no longer be constrained by the requirements or perhaps limitations in some cases of European law, and I'm thinking particularly of gender quotas. And I know that that was something that this Parliament has a particular interest in going forward. And there are some constraints on what this Parliament can do, actually created by the limitations of European Union law there. So there might be an opportunity there without those constraints to go perhaps further if that's what the Scottish Parliament wishes to do.
Okay, that's a lot of really interesting aspects that we have to all of this. We sort of concentrated this morning on wider issues. I wanted to sort of home in a wee bit on one issue, in particular rights of EU citizens currently in the UK, whether they're here for work, for study, or they've decided that Scotland's and the UK is their home, where you feel some of the pressures will come on that. I think the backdrop to the whole Brexit campaign created a very poisonous atmosphere, and I don't use that word that often, but I think it's a very poisonous atmosphere in the aspects of those who have chosen the UK as their place to be, and whether you have any thoughts on that, and whether if there's any way in this place that we can protect that, and I know that's very limited. I know I'm already answering my own question in that aspect, but we need sort of the thinkers of this land to think about ways that we can ensure that we protect people from that horrible atmosphere and actually maintain their place where they have chosen to live and stay and study.
Should I? Okay. Well, the rights of EU citizens currently in the UK are largely derived from the EU treaties. As an EU citizen, people have a right to come here to live and work and study under EU free movement law. And if they're wealthy enough, they can come here and do nothing as well, provided they have health insurance of some sort. Now, if people have stayed here for 5 years or more by the time EU withdrawal happens, they can apply for permanent residency under the Citizenship Directive. And if they get a permanent residence card, it will be difficult to expel them from this country, even after Brexit, I would say. So the ones who are most in danger, if you want, are those who won't have stayed here for 5 years. And they came here in good faith, you could say, before, certainly if they came here before the referendum, in the exercise of their rights. And there is no certainty as to what will happen to them at all in law, I would say. I mean, maybe my colleagues will disagree. During the referendum campaign, some arguments were made that there was such a thing as acquired rights under international law and that they would be protected. I think that argument is wrong. What was quoted was the Vienna Convention of 1969 on the law of treaties. It speaks of acquired rights, but acquired rights of the parties to the treaties, which are states. We're not concerned with that. We're concerned with individual subjective rights. I wouldn't call them human rights, but individual rights. So something will need to be agreed in the Brexit agreement, in the withdrawal agreement, about how these people who are affected, and it'll be UK citizens living in the EU as well, I mean, there are almost as many, I think, how these people's continued right to stay will be protected. That is one thing, and I don't think that'll be a huge political problem to agree as it's reciprocal. And an important question then is, of course, at the moment, EU citizens living here have a right to be treated equally, not to be discriminated against on the basis of their nationality. It's not something that is protected per se in the Equality Act. And we can see this with various rules concerning non-EU citizens. They are treated worse than nationals, for instance, in some respects. Let's just quote university fees. They have to pay more in order to study at our lovely institutions. Will these rights continue? So if at least for those who've already lived here in the past, who've had these acquired rights, if you want to call them that, will they continue to have that status of not of being immune from discrimination, or will that be possible in the future? Will we be able to require them to carry an ID card when nationals don't have to carry such a thing, and so on and so on? I mean, all of these questions have to be resolved, as well as the actual status of these people, that their right to stay.
Okay, Mary, do you want to come in at that point?
Yeah, it's just a follow-up question to the question that you raised, Convener, and the question that my colleague Willie Coffey started on in the earlier session. The earlier session I asked about employment law and workers' rights, and all of the panel members in their opening comments have answered the question really that I posed previously about what would be at risk in relation to workers' rights. But it leads to a further question, and it follows on from the discussion we've just had. For EU citizens that live here, after Brexit, what recourse to law would they have? Would they be bound by UK law, or would they be bound by EU legislation? If they were in dispute, say, with an employer, or they had any human rights issues, could they still say, I want to go to the European Court of Human Rights, or I want you to respect the EU legislation that, as an EU citizen, I am entitled to be treated by? Where would they be?
Just on the point of EU citizens, of course, immigration is a reserved matter, so it's not something that the Scottish Parliament would have a lot of power over. So it very much depends on the Brexit agreement, of course. It depends on the political mood at Westminster. In terms of just the question post-Brexit and EU citizens' rights, again, it depends on what is agreed. They will have presumably the same protections depending on their immigration status as UK citizens in a general sense, so in a human rights sense and so on. Of course, EU law won't apply, so they couldn't argue EU points or try to claim EU rights in domestic courts. Until such time as the UK withdraws from the European Convention of Human Rights, they would still have recourse to the European Court of Human Rights. Also, if the Human Rights Act survives, or the British Bill of Rights, we assume that that would apply to everyone currently resident in the UK, so that wouldn't depend on immigration status. Unless the British Bill of Rights does make a distinction on immigration status and the enjoyment of rights, which some people have touted, but I think that would probably not make it into a final draft of a British Bill of Rights, because it goes against the whole ethos of fundamental rights being fundamental, universal, and so on.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Okay, Alex.
Thank you, Convener. We live in interesting times, and as we've seen just in the course of this session, this very strange tale has taken yet another turn with the High Court ruling that the government cannot automatically enforce Article 50 without a vote in Parliament. In that context, and knowing that there are many unknowns out there, could the panel give us what they believe the extent of the parameters of these questions in terms of what is the absolute worst case scenario? What's the horror show that keeps you awake at night as the result of this? And what's the best case scenario? What should we aim for in terms of success in making this work and making sure that our rights are seamless in terms of, if in a post-Brexit Scotland, that our EU nationals are protected, that our own rights keep step with the EU? Can you set out those two parameters?
The question of this judgment, I think the most significant aspect of the judgment, I think, in terms of those scenarios, is that now Parliament has to give, provided the government doesn't appeal and provided that the Supreme Court doesn't decide against the High Court, because that, of course, could still happen. The Parliament can now set conditions on triggering Article 50. It's within the gift of Parliament to do that. I think that's really significant, because whereas there is some consensus around Brexit, it seems that it has to happen in some sense. There is not consensus about what it should look like. So the Westminster Parliament, through this legislation now, can attach conditions to triggering Article 50, including giving the government a mandate for negotiation, which is really significant. It could put in things like single market, could put in things like fundamental rights protections, could put all sorts of things. I think the best case scenario is something Norwegian style FTEEA. I think the worst case scenario is a hard Brexit for all the reasons that you're reading about in the media from day to day. That's all I would have to say about that more political question.
Professor Busby, I can see you nodding your head.
Yeah, I agree with the points just made there. I mean, I think we have presented the worst case scenario, you know, because we're looking at this through the eyes of those who are used to the status quo. And I personally, I would argue for retaining the status quo for the reasons that we've given. So I think when we're talking about this, and certainly in my earlier comments around workers' rights, I'm looking at the worst case, which is the hard Brexit, which is that we lose all those protections. Now, there are lots of things in between that and retention of the status quo. Norway's one option. Norway, the Norwegian model would preserve many of the protections, in fact, all of the protections that we've spoken about. There isn't a customs union in Norway, so it's different from what we currently have. But around equalities, around workers' rights, around other protections, I think it looks favourable. But, I think, you know, for me, the best case scenario, probably unlikely to happen, is to retain all the protections that we currently have.
Okay. Professor Robinson, do you want to come in?
Yeah, well, really just that if we were to retain the Equality Act as it stands, I mean, that is actually very good protections, and it goes indeed beyond European minimum requirements in relation to equality. So, as a starting point, if we're at the very least able to retain the Equality Act, and obviously that the type of Brexit, as discussed, will influence the extent to which we continue to see the Equality Act and the Equality Act perhaps developing and improving along the lines of the positive changes that happen at the European level, which, largely speaking, have been good for equality.
Dr. Locke.
Maybe in terms of worst-case scenario, I think, well, the worst-case scenario for rights would be that all of these rights would be repealed. We'd repeal the Human Rights Act, get out of the European Convention, and we'd be back to 1950, in effect, in terms of rights protection. I mean, because Britain joined the ECHR in 1951. I think it entered into force in 55 or something. So we'd be there probably before most of us, if not all of us, were born. So that would be the worst-case scenario. The best-case scenario certainly would be something along the lines that previous speakers have outlined. I think there's one issue that maybe is worth thinking about, and that is to think about certain rights in terms of reciprocity and non-reciprocity. I mean, a lot of the rights that concern this committee, the UK, Westminster, and Holyrood, to a lesser extent, can replicate. It's not a problem. You can have human rights standards that are good unilaterally without being bound by EU law. It's not a problem. There are certain the limits. You reach limits when it comes to these citizenship rights because they're very much dependent on reciprocity. I mean, of course, you could say, well, all EU citizens are welcome, even if other EU member states don't grant our citizens the same kind of protections. But that is an unlikely thing to happen. So I think it's always worth in the Brexit discussion, in the discussion about the Great Repeal Bill and what types of EU rules we would like to retain or not, to think about them in terms of reciprocity or non-reciprocity. If they're non-reciprocal, it's no problem retaining them. You don't do any harm to the legal order. In fact, you're just freezing it to a certain extent. If they are reciprocal, it might be difficult to retain them just unilaterally because they mightn't make much sense if you just retain them unilaterally.
Thank you. Jeremy.
Thank you. Two questions. I think the first one is, I'm interested, and I may not pick up fully in regard to where EU citizens fall in if they're in this country after Brexit. Do we not just become similar to those who are from South America, America, other parts of the world? Why would they suddenly become legally a different type of individual? I may have picked you up wrong on that, but I wasn't quite sure exactly what you were saying. My second question, if I can just move on. I was interested in the different bits of paper that you produced for us, and thank you very much for that. It took me back to my sad studies of studying law. I was the
sadly the first student that had to study European law to be able to become a solicitor, so I always slightly wary of European law. But anyway, I'm interested in your comments, Dr. Locke, in your opening paragraph 8 of your paper. Brexit will lead to the weakening of the legal human rights framework in the UK, which I thought was a very bold statement to make, because it clearly goes back to my previous question to the first panel, was surely we can implement all of this either at Westminster or at Westminster, and why does that statement have to be true? You've talked about the worst case scenario going back to the 1950s, but I don't see any political will within the mainstream political parties to do that. So it seems to me an interesting statement to start your paper with. Why do you think it is such a negative thing?
Jeremy, your first question, is that directed to somebody?
Well, anyone at all, whoever, if anybody...
Okay, no, Dr. Locke, do you want to...
Okay, well, with the EU citizens question, well, at the moment, if you're American, South American, or whatever, a non-EU citizen and non-British citizen, you can not come here and work without a visa, for instance. You need to go through the immigration procedures. You can't bring your spouse here if you don't earn enough money, and so on and so on. So you are in a worse position than EU citizens are at the moment. So that's what I meant. And you don't have a right to be treated equally. That's one instance of not being treated equally in that sense with nationals. As regards the weakening of the human rights framework, what I mean by this is that, it's good that you're linking it with the previous question, is that at the moment the human rights framework, in the absence of Brexit, is immune to reform to a certain extent, because without leaving the EU, Britain can't get rid of the Charter easily. I mean, of course, you could repeal the European Communities Act, but that would be contrary to all sorts of legal obligations. So it's there, and it's pretty much entrenched in the legal order. Now, if Brexit happens, it'll disappear, and so it'll open up human rights in general to further-reaching reform, because at the moment, if you've got the Charter that replicates the ECHR and adds a good few other rights, you may well ask, well, what's the point in, say, reforming the Human Rights Act and introducing a British Bill of Rights that will, say, make it express that certain serious criminals can always be expelled without having to take into account the right to private and family life, which seems to be, you know, one of the ideas that's being floated at the moment, if, at least for EU citizens, that wouldn't apply, you know, in the EU context. So it would only ever be a half-hearted reform. Now, you're asking, can we not replicate this? Of course. Being politicians, parliamentarians, of course that is possible. It will, of course, lead, and that, I think, is important to realise. I mean, EU law in the UK legal order has led to a strengthening of courts, generally speaking, I think. I don't know if anyone disagrees, but you can, as an individual, you can go to court, you can get those remedies, like a disapplication of an Act of Parliament, which you wouldn't normally get under, you can't get it under the common law, you can't get it under because of the supremacy of Parliament. You could, of course, argue, okay, let's take this power back and bring it back to Parliament, where it properly belongs. I think that is not a wrong argument in any respect. However, I think the main question those advocating this have to ask themselves, and they have to answer it, is whether parliaments are in practice able to really balance those rights properly, make legislation that is fair on those who are in a minority, who do not even have a chance to ever be in a majority in parliament, where the whole idea of the opposition opposing and then getting into power because they were such a good opposition doesn't work, because they are disadvantaged, they don't have the vote because they're foreign, and so on and so on. So I think that's, I'm just putting that out. I'm not making a judgment that is a wrong argument, but I think that these conditions need to be fulfilled.
Coming back to your Matt, we have a side of that coin. Is it right for unelected judges to have more power than a sovereign parliament? which is the other side of the argument, I suppose, that we that this Parliament and Westminster Parliament over the last number of years have seen things that perhaps we don't want to do being superseded by judges who have made decisions which have gone against perhaps where the political will is at that time. I suppose that's the debate, isn't it? Is it the courts or is it Parliament that should make those final big decisions?
Yeah, that's the philosophical debate that's behind it. I think if you want more power for Parliament, I think, I mean, and that is not because I'm the biggest fan of judges or anything, but I think Parliaments have to be capable of performing the function properly then. That is, you know, the committees, well, I'm sitting in one here, and so on and so on.
I get that point.
Just on the point about parallel protections, of course, it is within the gift of the Westminster Parliament to re-legislate the entire Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union if it wanted to do so. I would also argue the Scottish Parliament could produce a Scottish Bill of Rights because I argue that human rights are a devolved matter. The Human Rights Act is not, but human rights as a competence is. So Scotland could do parallel within its competence. So that's certainly the case. I think we have to look at the political likelihood of that. And I would suggest that the current government doesn't seem, British government doesn't seem particularly likely to do that, given their hostility to the Human Rights Act and the fact that the Prime Minister has spoken out against the European Convention, in fact endorsed withdrawal. So hypothetically, of course, yes, it is possible to parallel protection, but I think politically it's quite unlikely. On the point of unelected judges overruling, this is a common and much misinterpreted issue as far as I'm concerned. It's also something that I do a lot of research in. I think when we talk about democracy, we have to think about the fact that at Westminster, only one of the three branches of Parliament is actually elected. And so we have to think about that when we talk about democracy, if that is the justification of parliamentary sovereignty. So in some ways, and given the current makeup, the courts look a little bit like the House of Lords. They can influence the legislation, they can make recommendations about it, but they can't strike it down. That's pretty much the same power that the House of Lords has in legislating under Parliament. So it's a bit, I would say it's a little simplistic to say it's about democracy and it's about courts versus Parliament. It's much more complex than that. And I think we need to understand, particularly at Westminster, that, you know, only one of the three branches of Parliament is actually elected. So we have to bear that in mind. So the courts can look a little bit like an accountability chamber in the same way that the House of Lords can. Secondly, of course, it depends on your point of view of democracy. You have to define your terms. What do you mean by democracy? For example, some would suggest that having courts patrol a right to vote is crucial for a democracy, including perhaps prisoners. So, you know, the interpretation of what we mean by democracy and the role the courts can play in facilitating democracy and vindicating democracy in terms of ensuring that everybody has a franchise, people are not arbitrarily deprived of their right to vote, and courts can have a pro-democratic view to play there too. So I think we just need to be, I understand the point being made, but we need to understand what's at stake when we talk about that.
Does our other two panel members want to contribute at this point?
Very briefly, just one thing to add actually to what's been said already. I agree completely with the points that Cormac has made about the importance of an independent judiciary, particularly with regard to international law, which is the job of the European Court of Human Rights. But just one other thing about the possibility of replication of the rights that currently exist under the Convention and also under EU provisions. I think the complexities cannot be underestimated of trying to do that. I think it would be a huge job. There was some interesting research just out this week from UK in a Changing Europe, which is a project funded by the Economic and Social Research Council, which says that the complexities of trying to even negotiate out and then to replicate would be completely overwhelming and would take up so many years of Parliament's time in Westminster and possibly in the devolved parliaments as well, that it just seems like an impossible task to try and do that. So I think that needs to be borne in mind as well, how complicated the system is and how much work that would entail. I think, you know, we've got to think about that as well.
Professor Robinson?
Yes, I would certainly agree with that. I think one of the difficulties with this point about replication or the great repeal bill bringing over all EU law is the status particularly of the decisions of the Court of Justice of the European Union. We have some decisions of the court that have not yet made their way into amendments to the Equality Act. What is the status of those judgments, for example, pre-Brexit? And then we've got the issue post-Brexit of what the extent to which the decisions of the European Court of Justice continue to be relevant in interpreting the laws that have been brought over. And another factor is when perhaps reinterpreting, the British courts reinterpreting the laws, one of the principles that they would take into account is the intention of Parliament. If it was the intention of Parliament to legislate to implement EU law, then EU law is still relevant to that interpretation. So these are some examples, I think, of the kinds of complexities that we're going to see going forward if in this situation of just bringing over all of the... Well, depends what that is and what that actually means, and I suppose that's for the detail of the bill itself.
Okay, thank you very much. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Dr McKelly, you said in your remarks that a legislative consent motion would be required in the Scottish Parliament, presumably to unpick our own legislative compliance with the Convention and so on, and here in the laws and the acts that we pass. Could you expand a wee bit on that and explain why you think that, and could I possibly ask your colleagues to give a view as well, please?
Are you referring to the judgment that we just... my comments about the judgment that just came out this morning?
No, you said that an LCM would be required in the Scottish Parliament.
Yes, right. I mean, I've just read a summary of the judgment, so this is kind of a little bit off the cuff. But so the reasoning would be like this. So the court, from my brief scan of the summary that I've just managed to get on my phone, said that the exercise of prerogative powers, which is executive power, would have an effect ultimately of changing legislation. And for that reason, it can't, the act of, so the act of exercising prerogative to trigger Article 50 would go against the European Communities Act, and in under the constitutional status, statutes trump the exercise of the prerogative, so that you can't use a prerogative to undermine or bypass a statute. That's the constitutional position. Given that the court, my interpretation of the court's reading, this effects based, so the Article 50 Act, the Act to trigger Article 50, would be undermining the ECA. That means you would need a piece of legislation to change or amend the European Communities Act and give the government the power to trigger Article 50. That's how I understand the question. Given that EU law is sewn into this Scotland Act, as you all know too well, a change in the effect of EU law in Scotland would require an amendment of the Scotland Act, for which, of course, we know a legislative consent motion would be required. That's a very kind of broad nutshell type of argument, but that's how the argument would flow. It's a bit more complicated than that, but does that answer your...
It does help, yeah. I wonder, yeah. Is it too much to ask other colleagues to offer a view on that? Dr. Locke.
Can I maybe just say something about a legislative consent motion for the Great Repeal Bill? Because that might be required as well, because if a Great Repeal Bill says, well, all EU law that's currently in place will just stay in place, well, there's an awful lot of Scottish statutory instruments that bring EU law into Scottish law, mainly in the environmental sector, but also others. Well, CAP, obviously, agriculture. And that, of course, would mean that Westminster would be legislating with regard to devolved powers, and that would trigger a legislative consent motion, I believe, if that's what the Great Repeal Bill is supposed to do. Now, I think the Great Repeal Bill is potentially dangerous because, and that is where the Scottish Parliament has to be careful as to whether it'll consent to it or not. If it gives so-called Henry VIII powers to the government to amend legislation in the future. So what it might do is say, okay, we're going to freeze all of EU law that's currently in the UK legal order, including in Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, no matter what. That's going to stay on the statute book, but we're going to give powers to the executive to amend or repeal that EU law if they so see it fit. And that would be a massive transfer of legislative powers onto the executive, and I think that is... Well, first of all, it flies in the face of taking back control for Parliament, one issue. But secondly, it's really problematic in democratic terms.
Is there time to ask Professors Busby and Robinson the same question?
I don't really have anything to add to what's been said, and I haven't looked at the judgment on my phone or anywhere else yet, so I would be less confident and maybe more cautious. So I don't really think there's anything I want to add.
And the only thing I would add is to agree very much with Dr. Locke about the Henry VIII type powers. But is that how that's
described? Well, it's statutory power that just says the government is entitled to change or amend legislation.
Okay, thanks for the clarification. Sorry, Professor Robson. And so, yes, there'd be a real concern. As I mentioned, so the Equality Act is an act of Parliament and not an act of secondary legislation. This would make give, as I understand it, power to government to amend both secondary and primary legislation in relation to certain areas, although other colleagues are probably better informed about that than I am. But that would be real cause for concern, I think, and as has been discussed, issues around democracy would be a concern there.
Okay, thank you. More questions than answers in that respect. Is there any other questions from the panel this morning, our colleagues? No? No? Can I thank you so much? Again, we could talk, I think, for hours on some of this stuff, and as we say, it seems to change by the day. But can we thank you so much for your written evidence that you gave to committee and your evidence that you've given this morning. You've certainly given us some food for thought and maybe some actions to take in seeking clarification on certain points. So we really appreciate your time at committee this morning. I thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to suspend committee now to go into private to consider evidence from this morning, and we'll suspend committee now.